I'm a strategist, I'm a father, I'm one passionate mofo. So I've had the leaders of countries, presidents of the United States, presidents of the largest companies in the world, billionaire entrepreneurs, and I've had moms and dads and entertainers, you know, Serena Williams in the sports field, Hugh Jackman, Pitbull, Usher, you name it. So the one thing they all have in common, I think, is they're hungry. And I know that sounds simplistic, but I believe that's the single most important element that separates the quality of people's lives. It's not just the ability to have hunger, but to sustain it. Hunger means that you want more. You want more of yourself. You want to make a bigger difference. You want to be a better parent. You want to do something more than there is today, and that you don't get satisfied. Most people start out with hunger at an early stage of life, and they lose it. But the people that come to me are hungry either because something's happened. They've had a birthday with a zero on it. They've gone through a divorce. They're starting a business and they know I've got to have a different level. Or they're the best in the world and they're always looking for that edge that makes the difference.
What keeps you hungry?
I am hungry. I think what it is I think everybody is born with hunger. Like there's a desire to grow, to expand, to learn. And then disappointment sets in early in life for most people. And then we look to blame something outside of ourselves. And there are many events in our lives that can affect us all. We've all had pain and challenges. But I think if you can find within yourself the part of you that wants to constantly give something more than yourself, if you can find a mission larger than yourself, then you're more pulled to do something than trying to push yourself. And pull has much more power than push. I always say motive does matter. That if your motive is to serve something greater, there is an energy that comes up inside of you. So I feed 2 million people a year because somebody fed my family when I was 11 years old. And now this year we're feeding 4 million. I want to do more in that area. And every business I'm in, that drive just doesn't go away. Well, it's interesting. Since 2008, you've seen most large enterprise companies have really figured out how to respond to the world economic crisis at that time by cutting, right? They figured out how to cut their costs. They grew their bottom lines and they built up their cash. And so they've done very well. But that was 5 years ago and it's getting hard to keep cutting. You can't cut your way to growth at this point. So most major corporations are now saying, what do we do about the top line? How do we really grow revenues and sales? And so I built something called Coaching in the Cloud, which we've done for some of the most successful companies in the world. And what it does is it comes in and it revamps the sales process. You think about it, in the 1990s, you had all these companies that were re-engineering and they said, look, we're going to go virtual and save the real estate. And all these salespeople are going to just virtualize. There weren't great tools then, there are now, Salesforce.com being one of those, right? But the challenge is they've lost some of the disciplines that maximize the process. So we also, though, are showing people how to maximize technology. So I have a patent-pending process in a company that's working with everybody from General Electric to Reuters. It's called Knowledge Now. And it allows you to take the knowledge you need instead of learning the old style. We got great technology and an old way of learning. You get to learn in the application, like Salesforce.com. While you're there, you're able to get the answers you need when you're working on clients right now. Not go to some class where you're going to forget 90% of it, but do it right now. We found it to be really, really impactful. Well, I believe in rapid change. Technology allows you to create change really rapidly. And I think, you know, social media I've found to be a really useful research tool because we're living in a world where so much information is coming at us all the time that I always say, you know, it's like we're drowning in information, but we're starving for some wisdom. And if you follow people that are really brilliant, it's almost like having an intelligent browser where they can bring you to the very best stuff right away. I mean, one of the companies I have came about because I'm always following these people. I was following some 3D printing and I found out about this young man that when he was 14, he met a girl who had lost her arm and found out they didn't have the money for an articulated arm. They're about $80,000. If you lose both arms, over a lifetime, you have to get three for each arm. You can only imagine it's out beyond the range of most people. And at 17, he created an artificial arm that does more than the traditional arm, articulates, but it can actually, you know, lift 350 pounds. And it was all driven, but instead of $80,000, he does it with 3D printing and it costs $250. And I saw the site, he was meeting with President Obama, NASA gave him a scholarship, I reached out to him and now we formed a company together that's forming, we're building some exoskeletons for people who hopefully will be able to walk, taking those arms and being able to take it to places like Africa, all over the world with now at this price point, people's lives can change. My companies now together, the companies that I started and the companies I'm partners in do more than $5 billion in annual sales. If I could have ever dreamed that I'd have that kind of impact, it would seem ridiculous. But it's all come out of this hunger to constantly make things better and to find a way to do more for other people than anybody else is doing. And I found if you find a way to do better for everybody else, then obviously you have plenty of freedoms in your own life as well.
the dumb stuff that everyone's doing and stop doing the dumb stuff. Yes. That most of these extremely successful, brilliant people have just cut out a lot of the really dumb stuff.
They have. Well, they have, and they've done one more thing, though, that's really important. It's the most important investment decision. Imagine you got in the game, you're investing something, doesn't matter what it is. Maybe you're investing for the future, you're setting some money aside. You know what not to do. You know what you're after, and you got a plan. You made the game winnable. It's not some giant number. A kid will tell me, I need $1 billion, and I break down actually to charter the planes he wants to go on 10 trips a year, to rent the, you know, the Branson's Island instead of buying the island. He can do the whole thing for less than $20 million for the rest of his life and never work again, right? Yeah. 20 million versus a billion is two different universes, uh-huh. Different places. But the next piece is step four is really critical. It's the most important one of all. It's the most important investment decision you're going to make. And that decision is called asset allocation, or it's like, you know, it's like the ultimate bucket list. Mm-hmm. It's the money you put, it, what proportions you put, the strategy you use. I'm going to put so much in stock, so much in bonds, so much in whatever the case may be, different assets. That's what you live and die by. In fact, David Swensen, who's the most successful institutional investor of all time from Yale, $1 billion to $24 billion in growth in 2 decades.
Mind-boggling.
Worth paying attention to. He said to me directly, he said, Tony, all your returns come from asset allocation. More important than buying Apple, more important than buying any stock, you're going to be wrong on some stock. You're going to be wrong on some bond. You'd be wrong on some real estate investment. It's having the right breakup. And the guys that are the best in the world have figured out the right balance, like Ray Dalio, like David Swensen. And so what I have in the book is their exact proportions of what they do, recommended that you wouldn't be able to do. It's like I sat down when I was sitting with David. He let me come in. I'm sitting here in Yale's kind of hallowed halls, and I'm like, do you know what I do? And he goes, he said, do you think you'd be sitting here in Yale having a conversation with me? He said, your work changed my life, my family's life, this person's life. And so those things opened the doors, and they shared this with me. So the right asset allocation, think of it this way. Most of us make the wrong decision when we're driving a car and we're in the slow lane and we move, you know, or you're in the grocery store and you go, that looks like the faster lane. What do you think your chances of making the wrong decision financially are? You're going to make the wrong decision.
Exponentially higher than...
You're going to.
Yeah.
So if your success depends on you making the right decision, mm-hmm. you're done. And that's where most people are. When you know how to divide up your assets, right, they call it the only free lunch. When you can divide them up across different assets, so different types of investments, over different timelines, even over different countries, it allows you to know when the losses happen, you're not wiped out. We all know, don't put all your eggs in one basket, the most basic idea of asset allocation, but most people don't know what to do. Sounds so complex. I teach you in these three buckets. There's a security bucket where you put stuff in that is really protected. It's not going to drop. It's not going to grow big, but it's not going to drop. There's a bucket for growth that has some more risk, and there's a bucket for dreams where you do the fun stuff right now, not 30 years in the future, so you make money and, you know, in the end of your life, you have something. And I show people how to figure out based on how comfortable are you with risk, how old are you, how much time do you have to accumulate, what's your source of income. We look at those three things. We do it online with a little test, and then you can immediately go online and say, okay, here's a set of asset allocations that have been put together by people like Ray Dalio. I can compare it to whatever I have right now, and I can see what the returns have been over the last 10 years. Right there in 2 seconds.
That's invaluable.
It's mind-boggling. It's a dream. And I've only been able to do it because I've been working with the best people in the world, and they got excited about the mission. I mean, they got excited about seeing what could be possible in this area. And some of them, you know my background of not having food at times of Thanksgiving, and I shared with you that, you know, I've been feeding people. I started with 2 families and then 4. I started when I was 17. Now this year will be 55 million. I've gotten these guys to join me in that task. So Ray Dalio donated 1 million meals. Mark Burnett, or Benioff, I should say, from Salesforce.com donated 1 million meals. So along the way, these guys not only shared their insights, but they're playing a role to help people whose society's forgotten while we're also helping people through the book, which I'm really, really grateful for.
So once you know what to do with the money.
Yes.
Asset allocation, to use grown-up terminology.
Yes. Right? Just buckets. A certain amount of money I'm going to put where it's secure. Uh-huh. It's going to grow slowly. A certain amount I'm going to put where it's less secure. I got more risk, but I got more potential reward. A certain amount I'm going to enjoy today. How do I know that percentage? You pick that percentage and then you forget about it. Whatever you're going to invest, 20% goes here, 30% there, 40% goes there. You divide it up. That's all it really is.
And you just set it up to happen.
Automatically.
So you're not having to think about it all.
Correct. Or you model somebody else, right?
That's even better.
Yeah.
Set it up automatically based on their model.
Yes, of what they've already proven. Yes.
What's the next step?
Next step is you've got to create an income for life. And then when I say income for life, it's so interesting because I ask people all the time, why do you invest? What are you investing for? What would your response be?
So I'll have money when I'm old.
Right.
Yeah.
So some people say, so I have money when old. Some people say, so I can grow my assets. Some people say, so they tell me all kinds of things. There's only one reason to invest, income. Mm-hmm. You can have all these companies, but eventually you have to convert that to income to be able to live a great life. Mm-hmm. The final purpose of all investing is income. And most of us don't know that anymore because all of the marketing machines of the large banks, if you are taking income, it's no longer in their account.
So it's bad.
So it takes it away from them. So one of the things that I looked at was I started looking around, and most people know the power of life insurance, right? They'll like it, but I want to make sure if something happens to me, my family's taken care of. But what if you live? And here's what's crazy. The number one fear amongst baby boomers is not death. Death is a far number two, way down the list, number two percentage-wise. Number one is running out of money before they die, having a life where they don't have income. And it's going to happen, according to all the statistics, to about 75% of the population, right? It's mind-boggling. So what do I do without any income? That's why you see people now in their 70s as greeters at Walmart. You know, it's just they got to figure out what to do because they never figured this stuff out in the beginning. So there is income insurance. Income insurance is as old. It's a 2,000-year-old approach to making sure you have money. Julius Caesar was the first one who created it. And here's what it was. They created a pool of money where the soldier's going to go out. And everybody put some money in, and it was held by the government. And whoever came back, they split up that pool of money over time with annual payments. So the word annuity that we all have heard, the word annuity, is annual payments. Now you get annuities to pay you every month. But that process that's out there is one of the most successful opportunities for people to create an income. In other words, there's a stage in my life where you build, like you are. Mm-hmm. You're grow, and you're growing up the mountain. You're saving, you're investing, and you're building it to a giant critical mass, to a jackpot. Mm-hmm. When you get to the top of the mountain, there's going to be a stage where you're not going to want to work. You probably will. Guys like you and I will always work. You don't have to work. And therefore, you tend to work harder.
I couldn't imagine not doing it.
It's just like I couldn't either. Yeah. You know, Steve Wynn's a dear friend of mine. He's 72 years old. He works harder now than any time I've known him. You know, just crazy. T. Boone Pickens is a friend of mine. He's 86. He, when he was 68, he retired. He's a billionaire. He's made more money after coming out of retirement in the last 15 years than he did in the first 68 years. And he's having the time of his life, right? Mm-hmm. But you want to know you don't have to work. So when you get to that peak where you have enough money, mm-hmm. now you want to be able to ski down the mountain, enjoy your time with your family, do whatever you want to do, give your time, your energy, your capital, do whatever you want to do. That phase you need income for. And most people aren't planning for income. So you could be in a position where you built your assets up, your stock investments, your bonds, your real estate, and how fast can that drop by 50%, by 30%? We've seen it in every market.
About a nanosecond?
Ray Dalio says point blank, he said, whatever you invest in, most people invest in something they feel is their favorite. They think they know something about it. Mm-hmm. So he said, you're a real estate guy, you put all your money in real estate, and then you put all your money in stocks, or you put it into commodities, or whatever. He said, whatever investment you invest in, he said, mark my words, in your lifetime, there will be a day that category will go down 50 to 70%. He said, so the only way you protect against that is asset allocation, spreading out against many different baskets, not one. And the other way is you create an insurance policy that says, I'm guaranteed a certain income for life. So what you do is you take a percentage of your earning and you put it in an environment where it grows. And the only problem with that is, I heard annuities, and I was like, annuity to me was the most negative word. It's like
I know, you think about some sleazy insurance sales.
Yeah, exactly right. So you associate to it. Yeah. But here's what an annuity is. Bernanke. Bernanke, as you know, the head of the Fed, his top two investments were both annuities. Because I used to read these ads that say, you know, they still market them. It says, what does it say? It says, I hate annuities and you should too. Yeah. And of course you go to it and it's a guy that's selling you stocks, right? And he says, oh, annuities, they have all these fees. And he's right. There's tons of horrible annuities, just like there's tons of negative mutual funds. There's tons of people who've got fees everywhere. They take it every year. And the annuity side, there's a commission paid to a guy. He gets paid once. So I want to be really clear. Annuities aren't a great product. Like mutual funds aren't a great product. The right annuity. The right investment is the right one. And that means you've got to be able to strip out all the crazy fees. You got to know what you're getting. For most people, that's complex. I'll give you a perfect example. A variable annuity, very popular annuity, is filled with fees. It's fees on top of fees. It's fees to be inside of the annuity, and then there's fees for a mutual fund on top of it. It's a disaster. But there are types of annuities, like done properly, like these hybrid annuities, they call them, where it's tied to an index, meaning a stock market index. So here's how it works. You get the upside without the downside. If the stock market goes up, you get a percentage of that growth. If it goes down, you lose nothing. So, like, you think about my friend who's been out of the stock market for 6 years and he's got nothing to show for it. I said to him, this would have been one of many different vehicles you could have easily done. And what's beautiful about these types of annuities, when it's the right company, you want a company that's got the right rating. You want a company, these insurance companies, the good ones, have been around 100 years, 200 years. They've been around since recessions, depressions, the 2008, and nothing hit them. They're that strong. They've been around. That's all they do. And I said, so with these types of them, there's some now. There's some that are available. Most of them are available only for people in their 50s and above. So it's thought of as, you know, something for grandpa. I sat down when I started seeing all these work. There's one annuity I saw, and I'm getting old enough that I'm within the range of doing these things now. It scares me. But one of them gives a guaranteed return of 7% a year. And where are you going to find that? And
my immediate reaction.
My immediate reaction. That's impossible. It's, like, you know, it's a company that's, you know, A-rated. It's been around forever. But here's how they do it. You pay into the company, in this particular one, your rate grows at 7% a year, and then you have this lump sum. You don't take out the lump sum. That's how you get the 7% per year. What you do is you take out 5% of it a year, and so they show you what that means to you in income. Because what you really want is income. Mm-hmm. If you're in the stock market and it drops 50%, your income is just cut in half, and then to grow it back can take decades. So there's some that are tied to the stock market. There's some where annuities that are available today, brand new ones, where I saw this one, it blew my mind, where you take the upside of the stock market and they take what's called a spread. So they'll take 1.5% off the top. So if the market goes 10%, you got 8.5%. If it goes 20, you got 18.5%, right? Mm-hmm. And if it loses money, you lose nothing, and there are no fees if it doesn't make money.
That's so a much more attractive proposition.
It's mind-boggling. And then they have a second piece which says, if you leave your money with us and you don't take it out, if you leave it with us, then you can convert that to income in the future. And we can show you how much that would be worth in the future at different stages. So you're able to have something to plan with. So I'm talking about a subject that's really complex. I'm realizing I'm trying to explain this in a few minutes. I haven't tried to do it verbally. I do it in the book and really step by step. But take it this way. If you knew today that you could put a certain amount of money aside, and instead of wondering how the stock market was going to go, you knew that meant for you $5,000 a month, $10,000 a month, $20,000 a month, whatever it is, for as long as you live, and that even if all the money you put in, you'd outstripped, you'd still be receiving the money, that's what you get in these types of income insurance plans. And the way they do it is, some people live very long. Today, you know, people used to, Social Security was developed, you know, 1920s, 1930s, right, under Roosevelt. 65 years old is when you're supposed to get it. Well, the average life span was 62 then.
Yeah.
So it was for the outliers that were being taken care of. And it was to make sure in your older years, 3 or 4 or 5 years of retirement, you'd have some money, you'd be able to live your life, be with your family. Well, today, people living, you know, 85 years. So at 65, they've got 20 years of retirement and they have no plan. And that's the average person, mm-hmm. right? If you're married, one of the two people in your marriage, there's an 80% chance they'll live to 92 years old. So we're living longer and longer, and technology is just being started to really be brought to it. And yet we work for 30 or 40 years, and then we're supposed to have enough money for 30 years or 20 years. Most people don't have it. So these types of programs, and I explain them here step by step, these programs can give you the income for life so you don't have to ever run out of money. When I was with a gentleman by the name of Jack Bogle who started Vanguard, and Vanguard is, you know, the largest mutual fund in the world, but it's an index fund. So they charge very, very small fees, 20 basis points. That means 0.20 when you use basis points, by the way. There's a lot of jargon in this industry. I said to him, I said, I know you believe in investing in the market. I said, but there's a dirty little secret. And the little secret is called sequence of returns. That if you work and you build your whole life up to get this nest egg, and that's large enough that you can have invest in a secure environment and have income coming back to you. It's like your money machine. You don't have to work. But then the market takes a hit, then it can make a huge difference in where your income is. I said, versus if you have a contract with an insurance company that guarantees you that income, and the company's been around 100 and whatever years, or you diversify amongst multiple insurance companies, I said, those have been proven over hundreds of years to be successful. He said, that's true. I said, the whole dirty secret is, if I'm investing well in the first 3 or 4 years of my retirement, the stock market's up, I might have millions of dollars over the course of my life. If in those first few years it's a 2000 or a 2008 and the market drops 50%, I can show you statistically, you never get back to where you need to be based on your age. Mm-hmm. So having a balance of assets and having some of these, you know, insurance policies where I know what my income is going to be is the fifth step. It's really making sure that you put the balance in. In a different stage of life, you're going to be focusing on this more. I actually went to Guggenheim, one of the largest financial organizations in the world. I said, I'm wealthy enough at this stage of my life, I'm fortunate enough, and I'm old enough that I can go get these policies. I said, why wouldn't you do this for somebody that's 20? 18-hour days, there's a reason. If someone doesn't want to work, there's a reason. Now, here's the good news. Having dealt with literally tens of millions of people from hundreds of countries, or more than 100 countries to be accurate, I could be an idiot at this point and have to see there are patterns. There are patterns that'll make you angry and patterns that'll make you sad. There are patterns that'll excite you. There are patterns that'll make you grateful. The patterns that'll make you completely worried all the time. There are patterns that'll make you feel so absolutely certain you can run through an effing wall. Once you know what the patterns are, you can get rid of the ones that don't work and adopt some of the ones that do more often. And that's a good part of what we're gonna do the next few days to give you perspective. But the most important pattern to understand is why people do what they do. So as I told you, I've had a unique gift. I've had the chance to travel the world at this stage of life where literally the world is available to all of us in a few hours. But what I want you to understand is everybody has a reason for what they do, but the good news is there's only six reasons. There are lots of different stories, but I can tell you by experience being around the world, there's only six reasons. And those six reasons are called the six human needs. And I'm going to walk you through these. Now, I need you to manage your state for the next few minutes because we're going to go a little deeper on content, but we're going to do it only so in the future for the next 3 days when somebody stands up, you're going to look at them and you're going to go, what's driving them? And I'm going to ask you, which of these needs are driving them? Because once you know what drives somebody, you know how to meet their needs. Or you can predict their behavior and see whether or not they're the right corporate match, personal match, intimate match, because you have to understand it. So what are these six needs? They are not goals. They are not desires. If you travel with me around the world, you'll see every culture has different goals. Everybody has different desires. But we all have the same needs. What are they? Number one is the need for certainty. Certainty. Now, what the hell is certainty? Certainty is a survival need. We all need to feel certain that we can avoid pain and that ideally we can have some comfort. Why? Because continuous pain would mean continuous damage. Continuous damage eventually means death. So the need for certainty is built into every human being. And I'm going to show you now in the next few minutes, if you stay with me, and I really need you to, so make sure you stay, sit up in your chair and focused on this area. Because after this, we're going to kick in gear again. But right now, you got to take this in. It'll be so valuable, not just for this weekend, but for your life. All human beings have the same six needs, so why do we behave differently? Because the only thing different in people is two things. We all have the same six needs, but we don't value them equally. Some people's certainty is the number one thing they value. And if they're certainty driven and you try to change anything, they freak out. They get fearful or they get angry or they get pissed off because what matters most to them is keeping things the same way where they feel like they're in control. Raise your hand if you follow. That's an example. Some people, they value love much more than certainty. Some people value certainty more than love. So even though they love you, if they don't feel certain, they won't open completely. All right, just as one example. So the difference in people, we all have the same six needs. The difference is, which are the top two you value most out of these six? Because these top two determine your direction in life. And direction, if you keep moving in direction, it leads you to an ultimate destination or destiny. So we want to understand what your top two needs are. And same thing with other people. This weekend, when somebody stands up, often I'll say, what's driving them right now? And I want you to see, within a very short time, 8,000 people from 44 countries will all be saying the same thing. Because it'll be that obvious to you. You'll be a practical psychologist by the time we're done here. So now, if we know what these needs are and the person values them differently, we also have to find out two people could have the same need, but they have a different belief about what it takes to be loved or a different need about what it takes to be certain. Some people to be certain need $10 billion. Some people to be certain just need to pray to God. Some people to be certain need to feel like they have three perfect children and they're there every day. Some people that feel certain because I've always figured it out. I don't know what's going to happen, but I know I'll figure it out because I always have. You can get certainty from your past. You get certainty from God. You get certainty by working out intensely. You get certainty by eating food. Too much food especially will put comfort in your body. If you overeat, all the blood goes in your stomach. You start breathing again. So we all need certainty. The only question is that number one, two, three, four, five, or six on your list. And the second question is, what does your brain say has to happen to be certain? Some people have certainty that's impossible to meet. The young lady over here who was sitting in the chair before we intervened had a blueprint that's never gonna be met. It literally would make her unhappy regularly. So we gotta know what needs you're after and what's your blueprint. How many got a feeling at least what I'm explaining here right now? It makes some sense to you. Say I. Awesome. So the first need is certainty. How can we meet our need for certainty? We can do it in ways that are positive, neutral, or negative. I can get certainty in a heartbeat if all I want to do is get really pissed off and freaked out about something. When you get angry, do you get certain? Yes or no? You better believe it. So some people get angry all the time because it's their way to get certainty in a life that's uncertain. It has all kinds of negative side effects, but it works in the moment. So listen to me now. Most people meet their needs in a way that works in the moment, but not long term. So they feel good for a short time, like a sugar high, and then they drop emotionally, and they gotta do it again, whether it's food or smoking or drinking or whatever it is. So you can meet your needs in positive ways, neutral ways, or negative ways. So if I came along here and I said, what's your name, sir?
Chase.
Chase. Chase, I wanna make a deal with you. How much do you weigh? 246. We're gonna weigh you in 5 minutes. He says he weighs 246. If you're within that range, I'm fine. Here's my deal. I will give you, I'm gonna put $50 million US cash tonight into an escrow account for you. They're gonna weigh you. If you lose 50 pounds tomorrow morning by 8:30 a.m., you will receive that 50 million, otherwise they get it back. Can you do it, yes or no? No? Sure you can't. Take off a leg, take an arm, we can get your ass there. There's no question, Chase. Is the goal obtainable, yes or no? Is it achievable, is it obtainable, yes or no? But it's not sustainable, and that's how most people meet their needs. They use a drug or alcohol or food or cigarettes or something to get comfortable, to get certainty back. But the problem is it has side effects long term. Works in the short term, doesn't the long term. Raise your hand if you follow, say aye. So you could get certainty by overeating or smoking or drinking. What happens when you smoke a cigarette? Take a deep breath in and you blow it out nice and long and slow, full exhale. When most of you are stressed, how many have noticed that you either stop breathing or you breathe really shallow? How many have noticed this in the past? So you smoke a cigarette and in the moment it meets your need for comfort and certainty. It's killing you, but it works short term. That's how most people live their life. You can get certainty by working out. If you go on a run really intensely or you go lift weights and you push yourself and all that blood starts pulsing through you, do you feel certain, yes or no? And what's the downside? Zero. So there are ways to meet your needs that are empowering, neutral, or disempowering. The parts of our life we don't like are problems. Why would we keep a problem? We're all capable of solving it. Why would we keep a problem? The only reason you have a problem that's stuck around is because it meets some of your needs. Not all of them, or you wouldn't want to get rid of it. But enough of them that it makes it hard to give up. It's kind of like, who's ever been in a relationship way too long? Let me see a show of hands. And how many knew it was wrong while you were there? Let me see a show of hands. So why the F did you stay there? Because of the uncertainty. Because, well, I'm not thoroughly happy. I'm kind of unhappy, but I might be worse if I was totally alone. What if this is the best one I'm ever gonna get and I screwed it up? But what happened was most of you had that feeling, talked yourself back down into the relationship multiple times until one day you hit a threshold where your brain went, it was painful in the past, it's painful in the present, it's gonna be painful in the future, I'm out of here. Who's done this before? Say I. So there is a threshold that we can find, and if we find that threshold, we can break through it pretty damn easily. We can shift, we can get to where we really wanna go. So what I want you to get is, of these six needs, we all find a way to meet them. The only difference again is which are your top two out of the six, and I've told you certainty so far, and what are your beliefs or rules or what's your blueprint of how to get that? Her blueprint was make please everybody, which is impossible, so it won't work. Raise your hand if you follow, okay? So let's take a look. What's the second human need? Well, first of all, you can get certainty in so many ways. You get certainty by praying to God. You can get certainty by doing a ritual the same way every time. you can get certainty by lowering your expectations, saying nothing ever works, nothing ever will, everybody screws things up. You'll lose your dream, but you'll gain your need. By the way, jot this down. People will give up their goals and dreams to meet their needs. People will give up their goals and dreams. They'll even give up their own values to meet their needs. I'll give you an example. How many of you in this room consider yourself to be an honest person, very honest person? Raise your hand if you consider yourself to be very honest. Raise your hand nice and high. Okay, drop your hand. Raise your hand if you lie. Let me see your hands if you lie. You can explain this to me, will you? Here's how it works. See, in your mind, you know who you are. Why would someone lie who values honesty? No one told you to be honest. You want to be honest. Because if you think being honest is going to cost you one of your needs, like love or certainty, you'll lie. You'll call it a white lie, but you'll lie. Who knows what I'm talking about? Now, there's some people that never lie because they value certainty of always telling the truth so much. Right? It has to do with their rules or their belief structures. Does this make sense? So tell me something. You can meet the need for certainty so many ways, right? So here's the question. You can go ahead. Here's the question. What if you were certain every moment of your life what was going to happen before it happened? What if you knew what people are going to say before they're going to say it? What if you could feel what they're going to feel? What if you knew every moment before it happened what people are going to say and do? In the beginning, that would feel really exciting. But after a while, if you know what's going to happen, when it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, tell me what you're going to feel after a while. What are you going to start to feel? Tell me. What? Bored out of your mind. That's why God, in her infinite wisdom, gave us a second human need. And that second human need is uncertainty. We have a need for uncertainty. We have a need for surprise. We have a need for variety. In fact, what's the phrase? Variety is the what of life? Spice of life. Now, how many of you in this room, raise your hand, how many of you in this room love surprises? Raise your hand if you love them. Say I. Bullshit. You love the surprises you want. The surprises you don't want, you don't want. You call them problems, don't you? So don't tell me you like surprises. You like the surprises you want. Here's my point. Can you meet more than one need with the same action or emotion or belief system? Yes or no? Yes. Write this down. Anytime your mind perceives that doing something, believing something, or feeling something meets at least three of your needs. So anytime your mind perceives that doing something, feeling something, or believing something meets at least three of your needs, then you will become addicted to that thought, that feeling, that emotion, or that action. You can be positively addicted or negatively addicted, but you're gonna be addicted. Anytime your brain perceives that something you believe, do, or feel meets three of your needs, you'll get addicted to it. Now, I'm gonna show you why this is important. Let's look at two needs for a second. Is it possible to meet your need for certainty and uncertainty simultaneously? Even though they're opposite needs, yes or no? I'll give you an example. Who here has ever rented a movie that you've already seen? Let me see a show of hands. Get a life. Now, I've done it too. Why would we rent a movie we've already seen? We'd rent it, why? Because we've seen it before, so we're certain it's good, and we're hoping it's been so long we forgot enough that it'll be variety when we watch it again. Who knows what I'm talking about here? Say I. So you can meet both needs, but if you meet three needs, you'll become addicted to that behavior. Whether it's a good behavior or bad behavior, it doesn't matter. It'll be a positive addiction or negative addiction, but you'll be addicted. So let me give you, how do you get variety? You get variety in positive ways, negative ways, or neutral ways. You get variety by learning, growing, taking on a new goal, a new challenge. You get variety through a conversation with a friend. You get variety by praying to God. There's so many ways to get variety, aren't there? But you can also get variety in negative ways. You can smoke a joint, and maybe that's not a negative way, but it sure will change your state. But it has side effects, right? During that time, you're not going to function maybe at the same peak or understanding. Or some people use other things, cigarettes, alcohol, anything. There's so many ways to get variety. The question is, are your ways positive, neutral, negative, or empowering? How many follow? Because we all have ways of getting that variety, that uncertainty. So here's what I want you to do. Third human need is significance. The need to feel unique, the need to feel special. Yes, I hope that picture makes you feel special. Okay? The need to feel unique, special, important. Who has the need to be needed, to feel special, unique, and important? Who do you think has that need? Who has it? Tell me who. What about people say, I don't want to be special? Do they still want to be special? Yes or no? You bet your ass they do. Thou's protest too much. Now, they don't want to be so special that you attack them. They might want to stay undercover, so to speak, but they still want to feel special. They want to feel unique. They want to feel needed. They want to feel important. So there are lots of ways to feel special. You can do it by working your ass off, taking huge risks, and achieving something to feel special. Or you can tear down everybody else that's trying to build something. Because there's two ways to have the tallest building in town. One is work your ass off, take risks, build the tallest building. The other one is blow up everybody else's building. And by the way, which one's faster? Which one's easier? Which takes less intelligence and less money? Tearing shit down. It happens faster. So that's why we've always had violence. And we always will unless there's a consciousness change. If I live in a tough part of the community, I'm in the hood, and you can walk through my community and you don't notice me, and I feel insignificant, I might take things into my own hands to feel significant. If all of a sudden I put a gun to your head, tell me on a 0 to 10 scale, how certain am I you're gonna respond to me now when I put that gun to your head, 0 to 10? 10 is absolute, 0 is not at all. Where would you put it, quick? Yeah, 100. Is it true? But also, when I put my gun to your head, how significant am I to you in your life, even if you didn't know me a minute ago? If I got a gun to your head, how significant am I, 0 to 10? 100. I'm the most significant thing in your life, and a moment ago you didn't know I existed. And I don't need any intelligence, I don't need background, I don't need education, all I need is a gun and the will to do it. Oh, by the way, just in case there's not enough there to be an addiction, when I put that gun to your head, every time that happens, it's gonna be a different game. I know you're gonna respond to me, I know I'm significant, but what you're gonna say and do is different, so I get variety. So you meet three needs, but violence doesn't end there. Because the fourth human need is connection and love. And most people are too afraid to love because they've loved and been disappointed, or they've loved and then lost the love, and it was so painful, that now they settle for the crumbs of connection because that's safer. So it's a form of the need, but a low level of the need, but it's still part of the need, and we gotta meet it. So if you're going for connection and love, if I cut my gun to his head, on a 0 to 10, I'm a 10 of certainty, I'm a 10 of significant to him, I'm gonna have a ton of variety, but are we also connected in a sick way, but deeply connected in this moment, yes or no? On a 0 to 10, how much connection is there between our lives at this moment when I put the gun there? 100. How many follow this? Say I. So violence meets four of the human needs, and that's why we've always had it, that's why ISIS exists, that's why people do the stupid things they do, as they do it to try to meet their needs. The biggest cause of violence, though, if you'll notice, is 95% of the time when it's a terrorist, it's a male. Why is that? Because in the human nervous system, if you're masculine, testosterone is probably large in you, whether you're man or woman. If you're more masculine, you got a lot of testosterone. Testosterone is about dominance. It's about significance. It's about domination. And the higher that is, the more they want it. If they look at their life and they're not dominating, and they get really frustrated, they'll do a final act. Men will die for significance. Women will die for love. Now, some men will die for love too, so you know. But biochemically, a female is wired to be able to nurture and to support human beings. We wouldn't exist if it wasn't for every woman in this room, because we all came through one and we wouldn't exist. There's no man that can make this shit happen. But the women have, and the reason is because they have that connecting power as their strength. Now, can any man become more love-driven? Yes. Can any woman be more significance-driven? Yes. But our biochemistry leads us that way, which is why a terrorist will come up and do what they're doing and kill someone, because all they give a shit about is domination, is that I'm significant. And they want certainty in a world where they feel uncertain. And they want variety in a life that is incredibly boring in the middle of the fucking desert where there's nothing. And no one's working. Where you got 30% of the population unemployed. What am I gonna do, work at McDonald's or go kill people? Kill people feels more exciting right now. How many follow what I'm talking about here? Say I. Now, can you get significance in positive ways? Of course. You can be significantly more generous than anyone else And that generosity gives you a sense of significance because you know you're really a giver. You're not trading. You're not exchanging. You really are giving. And it makes you feel full. It makes you feel significant because you know the truth. No matter what you tell people verbally, you know what's true inside. And no one can mess with that. You can get significance by the way you dress. You can have significance by having more tattoos and earrings and more locations than any of us want to know. But the bottom line is you can know more about box scores and sports to be significant. Everyone finds a way to be significant. Most people find a way to be significant by having a significant problem. Why? Because if I'm really successful, you might like me for a while, but after a while, most people get annoyed with someone who's always happy and successful. Easy for you! Who knows what I'm talking about here? Raise your hand, right? But if you got big ass problems, who's gonna be upset with you? You're not competing with them. So you have huge problems and go, I understand. But if you're doing really well, it's like easy for you. So most of us unconsciously learn to create big problems as a way to connect because it's the safest way to connect and not be rejected. Some of you do it like she does by trying to please everybody all the time. Thinking if I please you enough, then you'll come to me. You'll give me what I'm really wanting too, which is what she wants. But it doesn't work that way. It works sometimes, but not all the time, and not even the majority of the time. How many follow here? Say I. So we have what needs so far? Number one is? Nice and loud. Number one is? Certainty. Certainty you can be comfortable. You can avoid pain. You can survive. You can be comfortable. Second human need is the need for? Uncertainty. Also need for variety or surprise. What's the third human need? The need for? To feel unique, to feel special, to feel important. Who has that need? Who has that need?
Everyone.
Everyone. And the fourth need is the need for connection and? Most people settle for? Connection because love is too scary because they loved and it was so wonderful and it went away and they don't want that pain anymore. So they want love, but they settle for connection. So if you can't get love or connection anywhere else, buy a dog. Don't get a cat, they're independent, get a dog. Is it true? You can be the dumbass owner, you cannot even feed them, you can leave for 5 hours, you can leave for 5 minutes and it's like you've been gone for 6 months, they're so excited, right? So anyone can feel connection and love, you can do it through prayer, you can do it through good gifts, you can do it by dressing special, you can do it by having big problems. The only question in life is not whether you're gonna meet your needs. The only question is how. And is it obtainable or sustainable? Is it empowering, neutral, or negative? And if you want to change your life, willpower never lasts. But when something meets more of your needs, it's effortless. If you want to know what the biggest addiction is in our culture, it's not alcohol, it's not some form of prescription drug, it's not an illicit drug, it's problems. Because problems allow us to try to deal with our deepest fear that we're not enough and we won't be loved by saying, it's not me, it's this problem. It's just that I have ADHD. It's just that I've been through this. So most people meet their needs through problems. Unfortunately, they don't meet their deepest needs because up until now, we've described the first four needs, which are the basic needs of your personality. But what will, everyone, by the way, finds a way to meet these first four needs. Even if to lie to yourself, if you gotta work 20-hour days, you will find a way to meet your need for certainty, uncertainty, significance, even if it's just you have worse problems than anybody else, connection to yourself, you will find a way. But the final two needs are the needs that create fulfillment, and they are the spiritual needs, not religious, but spiritual. The fifth human need is growth. We've already said it. We grow or we what? There's no way around it. If your business isn't growing, it's dying. If your relationship isn't growing, it's dying. There are no plateaus in this life. Who's with me here? Say I. So growth is life. And if you want a one-word key to happiness, I'll give it to you right now because it's real obvious having worked with millions of people. Progress equals happiness. If you're not even where you want to be, you're still overweight, you're still financially struggling, you're still not where you want to be in your career, but you start working out. You haven't lost the weight yet, but you start feeling better. You start making progress. Or you start to change that business. Still not there yet, but you're making progress. Or change that relationship, or change your body, or change your health. Anytime you start making progress, your happiness will go through the roof. Anytime you achieve things and you don't set up something new to go for quickly, you'll lose momentum, and in a short time, you won't be so happy. because the law of familiarity will come in, and this thing that once was this big dream will now just be something that you're used to. So the purpose of a goal is not to get the goal. The purpose of a goal is who we become to achieve it. What you get will never make you happy. Who you become will make you very happy or very sad, depending upon how you approach it and what you do with your life. So our approach here is we want to grow. And then the sixth human need is the need for contribution, the need to step out of ourselves. See, how many of you in this room, when something great happens, how many of you can't help yourself, you immediately want to share that with somebody you love? How many immediately, that's your first thought? Say, I. Why? Because you can only feel so much yourself. I don't care if it's sex, drugs, rock and roll, whatever it is, there's only so much pleasure you can internally have. You want to share that concert with someone. You want to share that experience with someone because by sharing it becomes more. It's more than just you. Growth and contribution are our fifth and sixth needs. They are our spiritual needs. They are the needs that fulfill us. Everybody finds a way to feel somewhat certain, some variety, some significance, even if they got to tear people down, some connection. But very few people grow continuously and contribute continuously, which is where all the joy is. How many follow here? Say I. So we're going to make a couple distinctions. But first of all, can you meet somebody and in a few minutes start to pick up which needs might be driving them most? Yes or no? Yes or no? Of course you can. In fact, I'll give you an example. I was flying, I don't know, this was probably 5, 6, 7 years ago. I was flying this small plane across the country, and I was being the pilot. And I landed in Kansas City. And I landed in Kansas, And I'm in this little airport in Kansas, and I get out of the plane, and this young man comes running out, and he's like so enthusiastic and so, just such a sweet, good soul. You know, you meet a guy, great hit off this kid. And he says, what can I do for you? I told him, I'm just flying through. I just need to refuel. He goes, how much do you need? I said, just fill her up. He goes, no problem. I leave. As I leave him, come around the plane to walk up the steps to go into the FBO, the fixed-based operation where I'm stopping for the moment. I'm going to go up and use the facilities. And there's a young girl sitting on the stairs here. And she looks really intense. She's gothic, you know, that goth makeup. She's got, I don't remember the exact number, but like 15 earrings on one ear. One through the nose, really intense looking little character. So I noticed her on the way in, and as I walk up the steps, I walk by her and go inside. And when I came back out, the steps are really wide. So I sat on the step just beside her. She's like one person away. And she looks up at me and goes, what do you want? I said, what do you want? She said, nothing. I said, nothing. And then we just sat there. She's like, you know, in her space. And I said, actually, there is something I'd like to know. I said, you don't have to tell me, but I'm going to leave here in a few minutes. You're never going to meet me again. Is that your boyfriend out there? She goes, well, sort of. Like, she wants him to be, right? And I said, that's nice. I said, he seems like a really, really nice kid. He's not nice. He's strong, she tells me. I said, okay, well, I think he's strong and nice. She said, well, maybe he is. I said, you know, I'm going to leave in a couple minutes, but I'm just curious. I said, how old are you? She goes, what does it matter? I said, it doesn't, and I'm about to leave, so why don't you tell me? She said, I'm 13, and I about fell over. I mean, this girl, I mean, 17 would be the youngest I put her. Totally made, you know, makeup made up in every detail, right? So I'm like, wow. She goes, are you surprised? I said, yeah, I'm really surprised. She goes, did you think I was older? I said, yeah. I said, and that kind of saddened me a little bit for you. She said, what? I said, I don't know. I said, I'm curious. I'm going to leave here in a few minutes. And she goes, you're curious about a lot of things. I said, I am. I said, how come, and I'm making up the number, it may have been 13, but it was more than 12. How comes 13 or 15 earrings? And she says to me, because everybody else has 5. Now, if I don't tell you anything else about this young lady, what would you say is the number one need that's driving her at this stage of her life right now? Nice and loud, go. Which one? Nice and loud. How many said significance? Raise your hand. Absolutely right. You can see it easily. But people are driven by more than one thing. And as I'm watching her in this really tough-ass approach and thinking about how she's adapted to be unique and significant, I look down and I see she has a keychain. And it's a Tigger keychain, you know, Tigger, the Disney character, Winnie the Pooh Tigger. And I go, cool keychain. And she goes, yeah. And all of a sudden I saw a little girl there for a second. And I said, Tigger, I said, where'd you get that? She goes, well, my dad got it for me. And she, all of a sudden, there's a 13-year-old girl there. It's totally amazing. And I said, really? She goes, yeah, I really love Tigger. I even have Tigger curtains, and I have a Tigger sheets. I mean, it's embarrassing, but I love Tigger. So tell me something. This woman's need, she meets her need for significance by doing what? Being gothic, being different than everybody else, 15 earrings, tough ass, makeup. But she's still a little girl, and she has another need called certainty and comfort. And where does she get that? Tigger and her dad. And you can see it right there in front of you. After this weekend, you will never see the world the same way if you stay awake. Instead of seeing people's behaviors, you're gonna see their attempts to meet their needs. And when people do stupid things, they're just starving to meet their needs, and they're finding something that isn't very effective, or it's effective short-term, but hurts them long-term. And because you've done this, you can have compassion. How many of you have something on your list, more than one, where you're doing dumbass things to meet some of your needs, and even though it doesn't meet all your needs, it meets some of them, and so you keep doing it. Let me see your hands here. Say, I.